Hi, everyone. I'm Utsav and James. We are from Builder.ai, and today we are going to be talking about our journey at scale. But first, I think what does Builder.ai do, or who we are? So we are a composable software platform, and we believe in trying to unlock human potential. So we are a platform. We allow people to build on their ideas and come together, and we kind of take care of all the technical details. So anybody, right, from an entrepreneur, a student, an enterprise, an SMB, they can just come and build their platform. I'm an associate director of engineering. James, I'll allow you to introduce yourself.
Yeah, as it says, I'm a technical lead for the developer service platform.
Perfect. So just a little bit of context before we kind of deep in. So Builder.ai under the hood looks like these different verticals that we have: customer experience, delivery experience, assembly line, marketplace, AI decision making. So there's a lot of things that are going out. But one of the core things that we wanted to talk about today is in terms of one of our platforms, which is called a developer surface. How did we start using Grafana Cloud? What did we use previously? It's a very busy system. I let the TLDR come in the next slide, but it's more around not only it allowed us to go through the process of monitoring and observing our customers, but it also allowed us to give them a better performance, understand bottlenecks with cloud providers that we were using, and a lot of different things. So I'll go next slide, and over to you, James.
So what is the Builder Developer Service? So think about it being a virtual desktop that we have deployed and configured for developers, or what we like to term experts. They can access this using a web browser from anywhere in the world, although we try and localize that to wherever they are in the world because obviously latency. The virtual desktop itself has everything required for them to do the piece of work that we've assigned to them. So it has all the software packages and libraries, et cetera, that it needs. And as the sort of the highlight on the right, there's sort of lots of numbers there, but ultimately we have quite a few of these things. We've got across 6 geographical regions across the world. Again, I think we're 2 cloud providers at the moment, but we'll probably be going to 3 or 4. We run in just our unit alone in the developer service, we have over 20 clusters running. We have quite a lot of metrics that come out of that. So you'll probably hear me talk about that quite a lot soon. Metrics. So what was our challenges? So basically, the sad kitten face, we had our own, so we knew about Grafana, we've used their tooling before, but we kind of deployed it in-house. We had it deployed within our stack, so we had Grafana and Prometheus and a bit of Elastic there. But it was sort of self-managed by ourselves and each team. It was a bit of a pain for me because it was not a big team, so having to deal with 20-plus clusters with the monitoring stack built into the cluster, constantly trying to deal with Prometheus and various memory leaking issues. Memory issues. So it took time, constantly having to manage it, maintain it, and stuff like that. So it became a real problem for us because just to maintain that going forward required lots of cycles within the team just to do that. So when you look at sort of a centralized solution, you want to look for various different things around that for us. So we looked at cost, tooling. So obviously we've got experience of Grafana in the past, so that's quite a nice fit there. How easy is it to set up and roll out? And when we looked, which was not that long ago, I think within the last year, there was very nice ways or easy ways for us to deploy that. We're very Kubernetes-heavy. So again, there was a nice sort of, at the time, easy way, a path for us to follow, whether it would handle the scale. And again, that's Grafana's problem in this case. So yay, takes that problem off us, but just dealing with the scale and the size and the amount of metrics to send them, and also the help. So from the professional services people you might have seen, I mean, we had one today, we talked to them, they helped us a lot with the integration at the time. So with all those things, we kind of decided, let's use Grafana Cloud. Ultimately, when we did this, I should say I've got an experience, I'm a background of DevOps. So when we say solution within 2 weeks, that's because I knew kind of what I was doing there. But It did only take me about 2 weeks to take the Helm charts, the examples they gave us, put that within our clusters and deploy that across the board. So we were able to go from 20 plus dashboards, stuff that's self-hosted, to an actual centralized view within about 2 weeks. And obviously, there's lots of other things you have to do at the other end of that, but it gave us that visibility across all of those clusters within that sort of span of time, and it was relatively easy to set up for us. So we didn't have issues with legacy things of login, et cetera, like that, because we could just lift and shift, basically. So it was a nice, easy conversion. And again, I should talk about metrics. So it's very difficult because when they talk to you, they always go, how many metrics are you running? How many? I don't know. It's really hard to determine it sometimes. But what it did able us to do as part of a trial period, we were able to actually put some of our production clusters on there, and we could actually work out a relatively good volume of metrics. So whenever we put a new cluster on there, we had a good idea of the costs going forward. So it was a nice, easy way for us to sort of get an understanding of actually how many metrics we were generating for each of our production clusters. And another important aspect was, at the time, they had the nice recommendation things for lowering your cost, and there's a very good, which I definitely recommend you use, but they have a very good example of board that if you go and log in, it gives you a set of recommendations about how you can reduce your metric costs. And we do that on a 2 or 3 weekly cycle just to make sure that we're catching those every time. So I think everybody's seen Grafana dashboards, but obviously you get some included. So this is the Kubernetes one. You just, you know, you do the integration, you set it up, and you get some nice dashboards for free, which is always good because, as has been alluded to before, there wasn't many of us. It's very difficult to get people to learn something new, so having stuff for free always helps with the adoption because you don't have to learn anything. Over time, what we did was obviously created some custom dashboards. So we were able to, for example, so an IDE for name is a virtual desktop, think of it like that. So this tells us the number that we're running on each cluster and how many, and we have an arbitrary limit of around 200, which is why that one on the red has gone red. It's not a problem, don't worry. But it's just telling us that we're running over the capacity on that cluster at the time. But we were able to produce that with Grafana relatively quickly, tying in with our logs and metrics and our database to actually produce this view. So again, I think I've talked about metrics and costs. This is the example. So we've used the dashboard and the tooling. So and if you look at the example on the top right, zero cost, that's great. but we on average are doing about 5 million metrics at the moment. There's a big spike there, but just ignore that. There's nothing to see there, but ultimately... but ultimately, it was a good way for us to be able to see what was going on in the system, and it all comes for free with Grafana. So you can actually see what's going on, you can actually see what's happening, you can see your costs, you can add, and as you add more and more, you can actually see that line go up or down or whatever. And again, adaptive metrics, I can't but recommend that enough from a cost control slight point of view, because it does affect ultimately how many metrics you end up paying for. And again, that's one of the things that we ran on a 2 or 3 weekly cycle, and they've made that a lot easier to do than previously, where you had to cut and paste, but now it's literally press a button and then either go through the list and apply it or sort of do a bit more things around it, but it's up to you. It helped us understand output on our logs, because everybody has logs, but we were able to obviously see across all the clusters and see the effect of a debug output. So everybody accidentally put print statements in there, or they've put demog mode on and you didn't realize, you can see it quite easily and it can help you understand that. And again, log storage is cheaper than metrics. and I'll talk about why it's quite important to us for that. But it is something to be mindful of. So for us, it's quite important. You know, we have a lot of metrics going along our systems, but we actually ended up using logs in a sort of an interesting way that I'll elaborate in a minute. So we have of all these desktops, we have over 1,000 of them running. We have what we call like our health check, which kind of is an inbuilt thing that checks to see what's actually going on in this on that desktop to see whether it's healthy. So basically, what does that mean? It just means it does a load of different sort of checks internally to see whether it can do X or Y or whatever. And we admit that as a log entry. But what we were able to build was just by talking to the Loki endpoint within Grafana, we could then build an API on top of that and then build custom logic depending on what it saw as an actual event or a health check event in this case. So it was an easy, cheap way for us to not necessarily have to build a big, scalable solution to actually take all this information that's coming out of all of these desktops and then build an actionable system on it. We don't have to worry about where they're stored. That's Grafana's problem. We pay them, but ultimately they deal with the endpoint and we just talk to that to get the actual health check information in this case out of it. So it was able to build this system relatively quickly. And now we have a system of, if something's not going quite right, it can run various things to try and fix that automatically for us. So we don't have to necessarily worry too much about the alerts. But yeah, that's a nice bonus for us because, again, metrics are okay, but we don't necessarily need that resolution of time of to the second we run this every 5 minutes. And when we're trying to fix issues and stuff like that in our system, for these kind of things, that kind of time of resolution is really useful for us because we just need to understand whether it's a transitory issue because somebody ran a build that they shouldn't have done or whether it was an actual longer term thing. And that's what we're tending to be moved towards. We need to understand longer term trends rather than sort of, you know, what was a problem 10 seconds or 20 seconds. I think I've ran through that pretty quickly, but
that's fine. We can save some time for your questions.
Yeah. Hand back over.
Thank you so much. So just a quick recap. I know it was a very, very quick presentation. So the developer surface platform that we have, it serves more than 2,000 active users at the same time. If you think about the scale of the system, we have 6 different regions that we have to support, multiple cloud providers. The challenge definitely is like we are trying to replace people's laptop. So their local environments, they have to now code into this platform that we're giving. So latency and all those metrics are really, really important to us. Any sort of issue that happens, we have strict SLAs that we have to adhere to. So it's very, very important that our metrics and logging systems don't actually eat the resources of the clusters in which they are running, right? So that's why having something which is outside was very, very important. So SLAs is something which is really improved after we've moved on to Grafana Cloud because it just gives you the pointers without taking too much effort. Cost management, as James already covered, the tools are really nice. It allows us to get a good grip of the cost and we are able to go to the level of what does it cost for this particular expert in this particular region just based on the cost metrics. The nice cherry on top is around the fraud detection capabilities that Grafana Cloud system allows us to do. So whether it was the logs bit so that we can see if there's any sort of anomaly that's happening or metrics ingestion, because it's really easy to tap into the Loki endpoint, it just becomes really useful for our fraud detection capabilities. Because when we're running a platform of this size, there are fraudulent activities, there are people with malicious intents that are trying to use the system. So whether it's the face detection system, something is going off that it has detected, or it's around what exactly an expert or a developer is doing on the system that could cause, because it's against the fair value of the shared model. So somebody can virtually impact other people on the cluster if they do something interesting, right? And everybody likes to hack into things. So that's a little bit of a recap. I'll try. In terms of the next steps, yes. So Grafana Alloy is very good. Sorry, that's the second point, but I just wanted to say it's quite useful. We're currently using Grafana Agent. The plan is to move to Alloy because we want to make it really, really easy for other teams to adapt to it. We don't want them to use any dev time, basically. It should be just a flag for them that they just set it on their clusters and that's it. We take care of everything else. Because Builder runs 100% on Kubernetes, everything is templated and it's probably the same set of stack. So it's very easy for us to understand what is running. And we can roll out alerts, dashboards, just as part of the base template. We have more than 70 services. So IDEs just consist of about 10 or 12 services. There are more that's there. So we're just trying to scale up and add more teams to it. Not every team has a DevOps experience. So of course that becomes a big challenge, which is why we are trying to make it as simple as that for them so that they don't need to. It basically is around them seeing the value and not actually putting in the effort to drive the value. Getting a service map for the entire organization is one of the North Stars that we are trying to do this quarter so that we exactly have those nice dashboards that I think we saw in the Dojo presentation that we want to show it in the office and probably start. That's a nice idea. So we should probably start doing that. But yeah, that's what the intent behind the service map. Tracing and front-end observability is definitely something that we are tracking actively. And we want to see as to how we can use the EBF to do the tracing capabilities, because it takes a lot of effort for an engineer to wrap their heads around all of the things and how to instrument their app. Not last, of course, the on-call integration with SRE. So we have a site reliability engineering team. They work slightly differently today, but we are trying to get them hooked onto the on-call system in Grafana Cloud so that we can start reporting partial outages. The wonderful AI features that we just saw this morning, earlier today, around how we can generate outage reports and all that is quite useful, because we can then actively talk to our customers and show them what is happening with the stack. And last but not the least, LLM ops. So Builder, of course, the name is quite obvious, but we are a very heavy AI tech company. So we have a lot of models that we run. We have a lot of LLMs that we use. There are more than 20 services that are running around LLMs in production today, which really involves that we need to have a lot of observability around it. And these are just not regular services. Like, there are OpenAI stuff, so there needs to be an agent around OpenAI so that we can see tokens, we can rate limit people, we can see what is the cost and the amount of metrics that is going out. So all of those pieces, and along with that, we have our own local models as well that we would want to put in some sort of pre or post observability so that it's easier for us to track what happened in this customer interaction. I'll take a pause there. Thank you.